Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and iOS 15.5 Beta 4 has been out for a few days. I've been using it full time on my iPhone 13 Pro Max as well as my iPad Pro, and wanted to share the overall experience. Not just my experience, but your experience based off the YouTube community poll that I have on my YouTube channel. So we'll take a look at the poll and read some of your comments at the end of the video. But first I wanted to talk about some features and different changes in 15.5 Beta 4, and then we'll talk about experience, battery life, and more. Now, the overall features with 15.5 aren't very many at this point, and the reason for that is most of it's in the code. One thing that we noticed from earlier betas is Apple Pay Cash. So Apple Cash, they've updated the icon, and they're also going to update the payment system. There's additional code in Beta 4 for paying with your phone or receiving payments with your phone, and we should see that enabled hopefully when 15.5 releases. It seems to be the one major feature that we're going to get with it. Also in 15.5 Beta 4 is an ability that Apple brought back that was removed with iOS 15.4. There's an Apple Music API that Apple removed. An API is a way for developers to use features directly in iOS code and implement that into their own app. With iOS 15.4, Apple was allowing people to use maybe Apple Music APIs to change the playback speed of songs. However, you can't do that in Apple's own app. However, you could do that with third-party apps. Apple removed that ability with iOS 15.4 and has since heard a lot of feedback from developers and brought it back with iOS 15.5 Beta 4. So apps such as Perfect Tempo, which offered that ability, should now work properly with playback speed. That's something that was actually confirmed by an Apple software engineer that's on the Apple Music team. He posted an update in earlier this week and let people know via iGeneration. So that's something they've reevaluated and decided to re-enable in Beta 4. Now, also something that's not really related to Beta 5 that I wanted to share, but a lot of people have been messaging me about, is YouTube HDR videos. HDR videos that are in 4K 60 only went up to 480p at this point. Now it's back up to 2160p HDR. So at 60 frames per second, before if it was a 30 frame per second video, you could watch it in 4K. Before that, you could only watch it in DVD quality at 480p. That's since been resolved, and that was done with a YouTube update and some of the code on their end. So it looks like YouTube's updated that. It only goes up to 1080p on some devices, such as the iPhone 8 Plus. So as you can see here, the same video, 1080p 60. So depending on the device, it may vary, but at least it's allowed in HDR and in HD or 4K at this point. Before that, it wasn't even in HD resolution. So they've since fixed that. So that's great to see. Now, I also wanted to mention an app that you may or may not have seen on my phone for a while. I've had it in beta testing, and it's called Acrylic. This app is now launched as of May 6th, and this allows you to create your own wallpaper directly in the app. So you'll see here we have different points. We can tap this point, and then we can change the color palette. We can change a ton of different things about it. So let me try that again. There we go. I tap the point. You can change the actual color. Maybe we want a blue there. Maybe we want a different color in this corner. Maybe we want, let's try yellow here. And you can see if we move this around, it changes in real time. So you can create wallpaper with this. There's a lot more you can do with it and adjust. But if you want to create it in any way you want, you can make a million different plus combinations of different wallpaper, then save them and use them on your device. So I believe it's a paid app at $1.99, but it's definitely worth checking out if you're into wallpaper. You can make your own, and there's a ton of different features in here as well. So it's really nice to see this updated. You'll see it says Welcome to Acrylic. So it's a brand new app, highly recommended if you're into wallpaper. Now, the overall experience of iOS 15.5 Beta 4 has been really hit or miss. Some things are better, some things are worse than earlier. So one thing I'm having issues again with is AirDrop. AirDrop continually gives me issues with Beta 4, where it seemed like it was fixed in Beta 5. So if I go into a photo, so here's a photo of an AirTag I took, and you'll see here my different devices that are currently enabled or available for AirDropping. If I try and drop it to the iPhone 11, we'll see what happens. than it sends. Let's try the iPhone 8 Plus, because sometimes this takes a really long time. So I've had this sit around for a good 30 seconds to a minute and not work. It seems like it's working fine now, but it seems to be very hit or miss, and sometimes it just doesn't work properly. Another thing I've seen in this update that isn't as good is the cellular connectivity. I've had a lot of issues where I'm just driving and it drops out. So maybe I'm listening to music, it'll all of a sudden say that cellular data isn't available, and I'll have to turn on airplane mode, turn it back off, and it reconnects. I don't know if that's when it's switching between cell towers or if it's something else, but I've heard this not just from one person, but myself and many others. So this is something that quite a few people are experiencing with beta 4. There's definitely some weird cellular connectivity bugs. So I didn't have this in beta 3. It seemed like it was fixed. It looks like it's back in this update. Also, some people are saying that they have lag. Now, I haven't experienced this. I've seen some people say that they have lag to the point where they downgraded back to beta 3 or iOS 15.4.1. On any of these phones, I haven't seen any one of them produce a huge amount of lag or anything like that. So if we're scrolling, whether that be in the app library, let's go into music. You'll see it loaded nice and quickly. It doesn't seem to be very laggy or anything like that. It seems to be performing as you would expect. So really no issues there, at least for me, but some people seem to be having an issue. It doesn't matter on which device, but I haven't had an issue here. As far as the overall storage bug, quite a few people messaged me saying that it looks like it's resolved. So if we go into, let me turn on dark mode. If we go into general and then we go down to storage, wait for it to load here. Now, while we're waiting for that, let me do the same on the iPhone 11. We'll go to general and then storage. We'll see how long it takes. And it does seem to take a while to load still. It's still calculating system data, and it does depend on how much data you have. But you can see the iOS size in general is very similar. You can expect around 9 to 10 gigabytes. That's typical. The overall system data on my iPhone 11 is 2.77 gigabytes. On the 13 Pro Max, well, it's still calculating. So let's see how long this takes. It took just a moment, and it's only 4 kilobytes. So that's a little unexpected that it's very little data at all. But typically this will range between a couple gigabytes up to maybe 10 gigabytes. Very few people seem to have any issues with it anymore, but there are some people with huge amounts of data that's being used. You'll see it actually jumped up to 8.7 megabytes. So it's an odd issue where some people are seeing gigabytes used, but I haven't heard anyone say that it's using over 20 or 30 gigabytes now. So it looks like whatever data was in there seems to be resolved. When it comes to Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, I really didn't hear many issues. The only thing I heard was someone that actually went from 750 megabits per second down to 650, but that could be any number of issues, whether that be the router or internet provider. So I haven't heard that from anyone else, but it still could be an issue for some. As far as Bluetooth, I didn't hear a single issue this time around, or with CarPlay as well. And with Bluetooth, with things like AirPods, when I open them near different devices, when you've got so many around, it can take a while to pop up, but when I'm using it by itself, it's nice and fast. Now there's an odd new music bug that's been discovered by TechCrunch, and I wanted to show you what that is. So what it is when you're using a third-party app and you have it in your dock, so let me switch this to Spotify with the music app, you'll see now I have it switched to Spotify where I had my Apple Music app. If I go into the App Store and re-download Apple Music, we'll wait for it to install. Once it's installed, it will actually take the place, and you'll see it did it already. It took the place of Spotify, which was on the far right, and then put Apple Music back to its original position. So that's actually a bug they've discovered. Apple's acknowledged it and will be working on it, and we'll probably see that resolved with the next beta, whether that be beta 5 or the release candidate. Now, as far as the overall heat of the device, it really hasn't been too warm other than just a moment ago. This started to get a little warm. It's normal for the phone to heat up if you're doing intensive tasks or charging it, but for it to get excessively hot, I have seen a couple people say that it is very warm. Most people said it was resolved with beta 3. So some issues are coming back with beta 3, it seems. As far as overall battery life was really poor the first day, but with a new update, anytime you install a new beta or a new public version, usually the first day it's working on a bunch of tasks in the background and it can be pretty poor. After that, it did improve a bit. And if we go to battery health, you'll see I'm at 100%. And I also use Coconut Battery to help measure this. This is an app that's not on the Mac App Store, but it's a third-party app you can install for free and check your battery health. And so it shows 100% capacity. As for the last 10 days of battery, well, if we take a look at yesterday, I had 3 hours and 21 minutes of screen on time, 8 hours and 6 minutes of screen off time. The screen off time doesn't make a whole lot of sense, and my background app activity is turned off for Twitter, but it's still showing there, so that's a bit odd. But I did use about 60% of my battery that day. The day before, you'll see 2 hours and 54 minutes of screen on time, 6 hours and 11 minutes of screen off time. Now today I've had it off of the charger for many hours at this point, about 8 hours, and I'm still at 75%. So I typically go to bed with about 50% left. As far as battery life on the iPad, well, that again has been very odd. Standby time sometimes is really bad. So I'll go to bed and come back in the morning and it's basically down to 0 or 10%. It's been pretty poor for the past few days. And let's take a look at battery life. Now again, with Coconut battery, you can see my iPad battery health. And also let's take a look at the last 10 days. So yesterday I used it quite a bit, 3 hours and 53 minutes of screen on time, 28 minutes of screen off time, and that took up about 75% of my battery. So it's really not great. About 5 to 6 hours of screen on time is what I can expect with this iPad now. Hopefully that gets improved with maybe even iPadOS 16. Now, as far as overall performance and benchmarks, performance, like I said, seems to be pretty good. I did run Geekbench scores on these so we could take a look. So if we go into benchmarks here, or Geekbench, you'll see on the 13 Pro Max, it scored pretty high. 1,732 for single core, 4,807 for multi-core. Compared to the other day when I ran it, it's a little bit higher for single core by about 3, and multi-core is 1 higher than before. But it's actually much higher than the previous beta, so it's doing quite well as far as overall speed and seems to be behaving like you would expect. I'll read the benchmarks on the 11 and iPhone 8 Plus. So let's take a look here. On the iPhone 8 Plus, we have 920 for single core, 2,473 for multi-core. On iPhone 11, we have 1,319 for single core, 3,054 for multi-core. So again, basically what you would expect on those devices. If you're wondering if you should install iOS 15.5 beta 4, well, at this point, if you're a beta tester, I would highly recommend it. And then if you're having any issues, report it in the feedback app to make iOS better for all of us. And then Apple can figure out what issues we're having. If you're not a beta tester at this point, because of the bugs that it's having, I would recommend against it. If you're trying to resolve issues such as battery, I would typically tell someone not to install it and to wait for the release candidate or the final version. And as far as when to expect the final version, at this point, it looks like we're having betas every single week. Last Tuesday, we had beta 4. I would expect beta 5 or a release candidate on the 10th or 11th. So maybe a release candidate this coming Tuesday or Wednesday with a final release if it's a release candidate the following week. If it's beta 5, then I would expect a release candidate the week after that with a final release maybe around the 23rd or 24th. As far as iOS 15.4.2, I had thought we'd already see this released. So maybe Apple's just going to roll everything into iOS 15.5 with maybe bug fixes and security fixes. However, it is possible we could still see an update this coming week. I'm not counting on it, but it is possible based on the past. But I'm really counting on iOS 15.5 on the 24th, sometime around there, with iOS 16 beta 1 on June 6th, and continued iOS 15 betas all the way until a final release in September, where we have iOS 16 released to the public. So I took a look at the community poll and put some of your comments on my iPad. So let's go ahead and see what you had to say. Chris Palmer said, iOS 15.5 beta 4 on my iPhone 13 Pro. Good update overall, smooth and snappy, noticeable battery drain when idle overnight. One noted bug after my update when receiving calls and over speakerphone. My callers have complained that they could not hear me, or at times they have stated that it sounds as though there was some feedback or distortion, making it difficult to hear what I said. So this is really the only comment I saw mentioning any issues when on a phone call. But again, certain situations are different for all of us depending on what phone we have, what version phone, what beta, and so on. Ron Leedy said, on beta 4, having issues with slow app response, can actually see display changes and modem issues. Then again, my poor iPhone 10 has taken a beating over the years. Maybe it's time for a replacement. I would say there's definitely a noticeable difference when switching from a 10 to even a 12. My wife actually upgraded last year from an iPhone 10 to an iPhone 12 Pro and said she couldn't believe how much faster it was. So if you were thinking of doing that, you could either get a 13 Pro or maybe wait for the iPhone 14 or 14 Pro. DHopper598 said, storage is still bugged for me on beta 4 and has for months. It says I'm using 53 gigabytes of system data, nearly half of my device's storage. Now, this comment was actually posted after I recorded the first part of the video. I go back and see if there's anything new. And so this was the first one I saw with huge storage usage. So maybe try a third-party app, see if you can maybe clear some of that out. I have heard about some success with that, with people clearing out the app data, and then it fixes that problem for them. Matt Barton says, iOS 15.5 beta 4 on a 13 Pro running smooth with improved battery life from beta 3. Gavish Rajwar says, iOS 15.5 beta 4 going good on my iPhone XS. Performance is great, didn't test the battery life, but it fixed the overheating which I faced on the beta 3. Facing small bugs like the music app won't play music sometimes when tapped on any song or by pressing the next button. Other than that, it's been great. And one thing I didn't mention in the video a little bit earlier is sometimes when tapping on music, it just doesn't seem to play. So I don't know if that's a cellular connectivity issue or if that just has to do with some bugs with the screen. I really haven't had any touch bugs, but maybe it has to do with just music in general. Masood said, battery life has been great for me on my iPhone 13 Pro Max on iOS 15.5 beta 4 without any issues, and it's been good. And by the way, love your variety of wallpapers and videos and keep up the great work. And as always, Aaron, I'll see you next time. Miha Justin says, using iOS 15.5 beta 4 on my 13 Pro Max, while the stability and performance is great, I did notice a faster battery drain as well as some heating issues when using the phone for longer periods of time. No other issues so far. I hope they fix the heating and faster battery drain issues before the RC. Keep up the great work. Thank you. And so that's everything for iOS 15.5 beta 4. Not a ton of real big issues, but some odd bugs that have seemed to come back, whether that be with music or brightness for some, or cellular is the biggest issue for me though, and I hope they fix that soon. Let me know what you're looking most forward to with iOS 16 and what you hope they change or update. I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.